Thank you for joining the online webinar, Innovations and Solutions in Tunneling, presented by the Greek Tunneling Society, Green Tunneling Society Young Members, the MAPAI Group. The speakers will be Mr. Alessandro Boscaro and Stefano Ansani. My name is George Doulkas. I will be the coordinator for this webinar. And I would like to kindly request that you mute your microphones, disable your webcam broadcasts, make sure you are receiving audio from your headset or other desktop devices. And please note that this webinar is being recorded. For any inquiries before we start, please use the chat and I will try my best to reply to your inquiries. Moving forward, I would like to hand over to Ms. Marilia Balassi from Greek Tunneling Society to make the introductory and welcoming note to this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, George. Dear colleagues, welcome to a live webinar by the Greek Tunneling Society, GTS, and our Young Members Group. My name is Marilia Balassi, and on behalf of the GTS Board and the WTC 2023 Executive Committee, I want to thank you for joining us today. The webinar you are about to participate in is titled Innovations and Solutions in Tunneling, and will be presented by two professionals of MAPEI's Underground Technology Team, UTT, Mr. Alessandro Boscaro and Mr. Stefano Anzani. Our event today will focus on three very important aspects in tunneling, which are key elements for both designers and contractors. And these are EBM solutions and environmental sustainability, risk-reduced waterproofing systems, and solutions for passive fire protection of tunnels. We are honored to have with us today two speakers that are not only experts in their field. Mr. Boscaro has a degree in environmental engineering and a specialization in underground construction, and Mr. Anzani in physics and materials engineering. But moreover, they are also very experienced in international projects around the globe. So let us gain from their gathered wisdom and find out what is new in the tunnel world. We would like to especially thank MAPEI Greece and the UTT team for participating today and for contributing in this webinar. Prior to moving on, I would also like to urge you to visit the Athens's WTC 2023 official webpage. As you may already know, Athens is the proud winner and will host the World Tunnel Congress in 2023 May in Athens, of course. And if you want to find out more about our Congress, please visit our website. The theme will be expanding underground knowledge and passion to make a positive impact on the world. So now for the webinar, that's all from me. I'm passing you on to my colleague, Mr. Doulkas again, who will be managing today's event. So enjoy your webinar, everyone. And George, you may take it from here.
Thank you very much, Marilia. So as you're all able to see, the agenda is as follows. Now we will be starting session one, which will be followed by a questions and answers break. Then session two, session three, and again a final question and answers, and then we will close and wrap up the webinar. Please refrain from enabling your microphones during the speaker's presentation. Type in your questions in the chat, and I will be moderating the Q&A sections in between the presentations. Thank you, and Mr. Alessandro Boscaro, please go forward. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, George, for this very nice introduction. So I will share my screen in order to show the presentation that I have prepared for today. As I said, it will deal about the innovation, especially in my part for the part of the excavation with the TBMs. Each one of these innovation will be there will be also one or there will be also a case of a real, let's say, application where this type of innovation was already used, And in every one of these innovations, there is always a particular attention to the environment. Just before going more in detail about the real presentation, I think that it's important to give you a very short, a very brief introduction about the company where I work for. Mapei is a company based in Italy, but nowadays we are more or less everywhere in the world. As you can see here with just shorts, with just a few information, we are in we have 83 production plants in all the world, with the presence in 57 countries. The turnover is quite important, and me, Alessandro, I am just one of more than 10,000 employees that work in Mapei all over the world. As we can see here in this map, one of these 83 plants and 90 subsidiary is in Greece. So also in Greece we have a production plant, and we have Mapei in DAS. Of course, I cannot go too much in detail about what Mapei do. If you, let's say, want to know more, I have put here the name of the main website, mapei.com. In general, we have 20 different divisions, each one with a specialization in some particular application. And in particular, the one where I work is the number 16 in orange, and it's called UTT. So in our division, we deal with the underground industry. Also in UTT, we have different materials that can be divided into six different lines. And in particular, I am in charge of the one for the excavation with the tunnel boring machines. So it was just a brief introduction about Mapei and the division UTT. And now I go more in detail about the presentation for today. It will be in particular about two different applications, the soil conditioning and the backfill grout. So I will start with the introduction, let's say, to describe what they are, and then going more and more in details about each particular innovation that today I would like to show to you. So we start from the soil conditioning. A short description about what the soil conditioning is. When the machine excavates, and so when it goes in contact with the soil, it's necessary to apply a pressure against the tunnel face. Not always, or it's very rare that the soil itself can be used, let's say, to maintain this EPB, this pressure at the tunnel face. So in most of cases, there is a necessity to add to the soil one chemical material that almost always is a foam generated with a foaming agent that is added normally at the cutter head of the machine and then along the screw conveyor. Its goal is to modify the soil consistency and make the soil with a in general, a better consistency that can be used for the excavation. I try to be more precise later on with the video and with some images. What Mapei in general can do for the soil conditioning? Of course, we have a range of different foaming agents with different name, different formulations and so on, according to the geology, to the particular case. But we try to have more in general a global or a bigger approach. For example, before the machine we start, we can analyze all the information that is available. We are available to carry out tests in our laboratory, and as a goal, let's say, to define and to choose the forming agent for each single case. So to have, let's say, a better visualization of what I want to say is this is an example of a sample of soil in our laboratory, in particular a sand or a silty sand without any consistency. And of course, this type of soil without any conditioning can't be used during the EPB advance. So we are going to add the foam that is generated with a machine like this. Of course, this is in our laboratory, but the principle is the same of the one that there is in every tunnel boring machine. And with the right choice of the foam and with the right addition of this foam, the goal is to arrive to a soil with such a consistency that, of course, is very good for the EPB excavation. And then after this, there is all the approach that we have also on site where we can work together with the designer, with the contractor and so on to optimize the use of the foam. And then in the time to monitor all the most important parameters of the machine, the foam consumption and so on. I hope that everybody of you will be able to see this. It's a video, and then there is a comparison between the same type of soil in the same job site that particularly it was in Bucharest some years ago. I think it's very interesting because in this video on the left, you will see here we are at the end of the screw conveyor, and on the bell conveyor you will see the soil with a very good soil conditioning. On the opposite here, it will be the same type of soil, but of course with some, let's say, with a mistake in the conditioning, and you will see that the result will be completely opposite. So I start the video just very briefly. So in this case, it's clear that the soil is okay, let's say, for the excavation. The extraction from the screw conveyor is continuous. And same type of soil, but with a wrong conditioning. It can be wrong choice of the foaming agent or a wrong addition of foam and water and so on. In this case, it's clear that the clay is not good enough for the excavation, and this is not just a problem to see that the clay is not good enough. It's a problem for the excavation because the machine, this clay can be sticky on the machine, and there can be a problem even for the advance of the machine. So let's say it's clear for everybody, because there is already a lot of experiences in the last 20 or more years, that the soil conditioning is very important from the operational point of view in every EPB, because with the good soil conditioning, we can improve the water control, we can control the EPB at the tunnel face. So in general, we will have a safer excavation, we will have a lower energy consumption, less wear, and so on. So this, I think that it's already quite clear and established, let's say. What, in my opinion and in my experience, is a bit less clear, and where there is a bit less of experience in the world, is that when we do the soil conditioning, we add a chemical agent to the soil. And so the soil conditioning is not only a matter of technical performance, but also of environment. So, and this is environment, the environmental impact that inevitably there is when we add a chemical during the excavation, can go in two ways. It can go to the underground water, because the machine excavates, of course, below the water table. Somehow the foam will go in contact with this water. And even more, this foam will remain into the soil that is excavated and that will be extracted. I think it's important to underline that we speak about amounts of soil that are really very important. For example, if I remember well, I hope not to be wrong, when we excavate with the TBM with a diameter of 10 meters, we will generate around 120 tons of soil per just one linear meter of advance. And in each one of these cubic meter of soil, there is around 1 or 2 kg of foaming agent, so of a chemical material. So what will be the impact of this addition? The foam will remain into the soil or it will disappear if it remains? Will it have some impact against the water and the soil and so on? And in general, the tunnel muck is a waste, is a dangerous waste. Can it be reused and so on? Let's say, unfortunately, we have seen that there is a very different approach more or less everywhere. If the TBM job is in Italy, there will be one approach to this issue of the environmental impact of soil conditioning. Another one, there will be in France, in Spain, in UK, in Greece for sure, and everywhere. So of course the reply to the last point, if the tunnel muck will be a waste or whatever, this depends very much on the single rule for every single job. What does not change and what is true, let's say, everywhere and even more where we can work is with the formulation of our materials. And with our R&D, we have seen in the last years that a lot of things can be done with foaming agents in order to minimize the environmental impact of these materials against the water and against the soil. In particular, I said we speak about organic material, so their degree or environmental impact can be defined in two ways, with their biodegradability and with their ecotoxicity. As I said before, in the last years, we have seen with our R&D and then with the real experiences on site in Italy, but not only in Italy, that with some materials, in particular the one that belong to our polyfoamer ECO, we can improve very much this issue. So we will have some materials with more biodegradability, means higher biodegradability in a shorter time, and with less ecotoxicity. So let's say the first innovation that is in my presentation, I have, let's say, called it a sustainable soil conditioning. It means these two things together, the technical performance and respect to the environment. These two things is very important that they go together, because of course we can have foam with a very low environmental impact, but there is a possibility that this foam you have to edit at a dosage that is very big in order to have a good result in terms of soil conditioning, TBM, advance, and so on. So it's very important that these two aspects go together in order to arrive to what I have defined a sustainable soil conditioning. Some experiences that we already have with this material of the polyfoamer ECO The first one is a project in Italy, a railway in northwest of Italy, where there are, let's say, five EPB machines, or to be more precise, three of them have already completed their excavation, while other two are still now in work. Diameter is 9.7, and in total more than 30 kilometers have already been excavated. So the distance is already very big, and you can imagine that a lot of different geologies have already been excavated. Another example is again in Italy, where the same material like before was selected for the soil conditioning after the test of technical performances and environmental impact. In particular, in this job, I would like to underline the diameter of the machine, 15.9, the tunnel Santa Lucia. Sorry, I forgot to say its name. The diameter that I underline it because it's the at the time of its excavation, it was the biggest machine in all the world, and if I remember well, in Europe is the biggest machine ever used. And of course, the big diameter means also a more difficult soil condition. The soil or the muck has to remain in pressure for a much longer time than in a small machine. So the soil conditioning is even more important than in a small machine. And the last example is just to show us an example, not only in Italy, but going abroad. It's a project in Argentina, the tunnel Riachuelo in Buenos Aires. Here I underline 12 kilometers excavated mainly in sand with an EPB that in average was more than 4 bar, so quite a big value for an EPB machine. What do I mean about the minimization of the environmental impact of the foam? In our opinion, it's very important that what I said before, the ecotoxicity and the biodegradability of the pure foam, that they are certified by an external laboratory. In particular, we used to use the approach of the of this laboratory that is based in Germany, and that classify the chemical materials into three different groups that are called WGK1, WGK2, and WGK3. The class of the WGK1 is the one with the lowest risk against water. So we have this approach that all the materials that we want to use for the soil conditioning must have a certification of WGK1, because this is already a good approach in order to have a low risk, let's say, against water. The other thing that I said before is the ecotoxicity. So just two examples of a comparison between one of the new polyfoamer eco, against two other polyfoamer, let's say more traditional, let's say. And this is a comparison between the value of the toxicity against the fish that is called EC50. What this value means, for example, when we go to the polyfoamer eco, we see 3,500. This is the concentration in water of this material that will have a toxic effect against the 50% of the population of this fish that is used for the test. So it's clear that for this material, the concentration that will have this effect is much, much more than for the traditional materials. In particular, against the fish, we speak about a value between between 50 and 100 times. Another example is against another organism, the alga. In this value, in this case, there is an index that is called IC, and again the comparison is very clear. And again, we see a difference that is very important because between the one of the polyphomer eco and two of other more traditional materials. Of course, all these data come from an external laboratory, so they are not invented, or it's not just an internal test, but they are all certified by external laboratories. So when we have a material with a WGK1 with a high degree of biodegradability, and even more when we see that the values of the ecotoxicity are so low, of course we go in the direction to have a lower impact again against the underground water, and even more against all the muck that is extracted and that will have to be disposed somewhere. Second topic, again, about the soil conditioning. In this case, we have a different approach. So we don't speak about impact against the water or the soil, but in this case, we see this sustainable soil conditioning in the approach of a reduction of the water used. Many of us, me included, many times, I think, okay, it's just water, so it's not so important how much I will add for the soil conditioning. Somehow it's true, because for sure the water will be less expensive than the foaming agent, but it's not completely true. And there can be even some case where it's impossible to have available a big amount of water. And in any case, I am convinced that another way to see a sustainable soil conditioning is to minimize, as much as possible, of course, the use of the water. So in this case, the example that I bring, there are two. One is with a lab, with the test in the laboratory with the sample of the London clay, so a type of clay very well known. Here we see an example of a slump with where let's say a basic foam was used. A basic foam, I want to mean based only on the surfactants. In particular, the laboratory in this case, we speak about the laboratory of the University in Torino. Arrived to this result of soil conditioning using these parameters. The concentration, fear and fear, I don't go too much in detail. Anyway, they are about the use of the foam, so how the foam is concentrated, generated, and so on. And then we have the addition of pure water. So in this case, they have achieved this result with the 16%. Test after test, we have arrived to a decrease quite important of the water that was added with the use of a different foaming agent, where we have the same concentration of the surfactants, but the addition of another ingredient, let's say, that is particularly designed as anti-clay, so a clay dispersing agent that can minimize, can fluidify the clay and can minimize its stickiness, its sticky effect. So yes, we passed from 16 to 9% of this addition, and all the other parameters that are related to the foam, they remain the same. The same thing is confirmed also with another test that we call the torque meter, where there is a disc rotating into the soil, and the torque, and there is a measurement of the torque. So again, the torque when this particular foam with the anti-clay ingredient is used, the torque remain in the time at a lower value and does not increase like in the case of a basic foam that is used, so simply based on surfactants. What does it mean, a reduction from 16 to 9%? Of course, it's just an example, but it's to give you the idea of what it means. Speaking about a diameter of 10 meters, we are about more than 5 tons of water reduced for each advance. So for example, when we go to an excavation of 10 kilometers, this number really becomes very big, more than 55 tons of water. And also in this case, an example of where this material was used, it's a lot of the Grand Paris in France, in particular the line 16, lot number one. The Grand Paris in these years, there are a lot of machines under excavation, and a lot of the soils that are excavated have a lot of issues with the stickiness effect. So also in this case, the use of the right polyfoam or of the right foam has allowed the reduction of the water. So I close with the topic of the soil conditioning. I go to the one of the backfill grout that will be a bit, let's say, some less slides compared to the soil conditioning. Anyway, again, when a short introduction about what the backfill grout is. When every type of machine advances, so an EPB, a slurry, or a rock machine with the shield, there is a gap at the end of the shield that must be filled with the grout. Especially when we excavate in a soil, this injection has to be done as fast as possible in order to avoid or to minimize movement of the soil and so on. Here we are in a job in Buenos Aires. We see very well the injection of this grout because here we are at the extra dos of the ring, and then we have the soil, and we see this grout that has filled very well all this gap between the concrete ring and the soil. The most used type of backfill grout is the so-called two component that is based on a component A that includes all these ingredients from the water, the bentonite, the cement, and the retarding agent. And then we have a component B, or an accelerator, that is added just at the end of the injection line. So we have a component A and a component B. Again, what MAPEI can do for the grout, we have all the type of material from the retarder, accelerator, stabilizer, and so on. And also for this case, we can have a general approach, so not just the definition of the material, but we can work to define the mix design according to the raw material available on site, mainly the cement, and according to every single request, for example, the strength that we receive from each job. Just a few examples of all the tests that we can carry out, and this can be done both in the laboratory to define the mix design, and then also when we arrive on site, because another part, let's say, of our activities when the batching plant on site is ready, we go and we try to confirm with the plant what we got before in our laboratory. So in this case, I will speak about two innovations, again, with a particular attention to the environmental impact. The first one, I have defined the semen-free backfill grout, because as I will show, in this type of grout, the cement is replaced by other materials. And the main advantage is again related to the environment. And in this case, it's quantified with the reduction of the CO2 emission. It's a topic that is becoming more and more important. For example, we see a lot of these requests coming to us in, for example, in UK or in Italy, in Norway, in Denmark, in Canada, and so on. So we try to put more and more attention to this issue of the CO2 emission. So coming to the grout, as I said, we pass from this traditional mixed design that of course is based on cement to another one where the cement is completely 100% replaced by other two materials. In particular, we have a binder and we have an activator for it. So completely cement-free grout. How the advantage of the CO2 reduction is quantified? We use the approach that is called life cycle assessment, LCA. Comes from this guideline ISO 14000, etc. We use this LCA because it's the one that quantifies all the emission for each single ingredient, let's say from the beginning to the end, because it includes in the calculation of the emissions all the manufacturing, packaging, distribution, and so on. So it's a very complete approach to this issue. And then in particular, the most important index that is calculated by the LCA is called WGP, so Global Warming Potential. And with this index, the CO2 emissions are calculated. So what we have done, this is the WGP for a traditional cement, same type one. This is a value, of course, it will be different everywhere, but this is the official one that we got in Italy from the Association of the Cement Producers. I imagine that in Greece you will have another one like in France, but again, we speak about an example and at the end the result will be the same. And we have calculated the same, the WGP, for our materials that would replace the cement. So in particular, these are the CO2 emission for the CVSR, for the binder and for its activator. Okay, the next step is to arrive to calculate the CO2 emission of the grout that includes these ingredients. So we start with a normal, a traditional two-component grout. I estimated a consumption of cement of 300 kg, that is, of course, an example. It can go from 250 to 380, but okay, it's to make a point and to compare. So with the 300 kg of cement, 1 cubic meter of this grout will have an emission of CO2 of 365 kg. When we pass to the cement-free grout, and there are a lot of tests that can show also made by external laboratories that can show that the grout will have the same technical performances of the cement grout, we will reduce CO2 emission down to 115. So we speak about a reduction of around 70%. This number will become even more impressive, let's say, when we don't speak about just a cubic meter, but when we speak about, for example, 1 kilometer of excavation. I consider 6 cubic meters of grout, and we speak about a reduction of 1,500 tons. If we go to 10 kilometers of excavation, this reduction will be 15,000 tons. When I saw this information, honestly, I didn't know exactly what it means. So I made some research in Google, and to make a comparison and to let you understand a bit more about what we speak about, the emission of a car is in average 0.1 CO2 per each kilometer. So we must arrive to a car that has to drive 3,000 times around the equator in order to have this 15,000 ton of CO2 emission. 15,000 ton of CO2 emission is also the emission for the lightening of 1 year of the city of Milano. So, of course, it's just an example. This is a number that can vary according to many different things, but I think that it's quite clear that what can be done in terms of CO2 emission when the cement is replaced by other types of material. Last innovation will be just a couple of minutes. About the cement, backfill grout, and in this case we see it again from a different approach. So we see the environmental impact from the approach of the reuse of recycled waters. So in this case, I start from a real example, the Brennero job site in Italy, where free rock machines are used. The goal of this job was, and still now is, to collect all the waters from the free machines. There is a mechanical treatment of this water, so the solid is removed with a filter press. And then they have this goal to recycle all this water for the backfill grout production. So these are the general parameters of the grout when clean water is used, without going too much in detail, but the comparison when recycled water is used, replacing the clean water, there is a big issue with bleeding, so with the water exudation. In this case, we have a grout that is not stable at all. So if this type of grout is used, it will create a lot of issues for the during the excavation in the lines and so on. So of course, in this case, we see that the pure use of the recycled water would be impossible. But again, with some job, so with some idea, with some innovation after the R&D activity and then the concretization of it in the job site, we arrived to a solution of this problem. Because with just a small addition of a polymer, of a stabilizer, and we speak about just 1 kg per cubic meter of grout, we are able to arrive again to a good value of the water exudation that is completely comparable to the first case when the clean water is used. So again, just the addition of a very small amount of this stabilizer is helping to save per each day of working with the three machines together to save around 3,000 liters of water that don't have to be treated and let's say thrown away, but they can be recycled for the grout production. 3,000 liters per each day, of course, when we increase it and see this issue for 1 week, 1 month, and 1 year, we start to speak about a volume that is very important, and so again, there is a good approach about the environmental impact. So, to conclude my presentation, I hope that it was not too long and to be on time. What I have presented is four innovations, technological innovations, two about the soil conditioning and two about the backfill grout, each one of these with a focus to the environmental impact. Each one of these with already a case or more than one of concrete use on a job site. The final thing that I think is the most important is that, in my opinion, environmental impact does not want to mean that we reduce the technical performances of the material, of the, for example, of the foam for the soil conditioning or in general of the backfill grout. There is a way that allows us to put the two things together. A lot of job has already been done in the last years, so we have arrived already, I think, to a good point. But of course, the R&D map is always at work, so I'm also sure that a goal for the next years will be to go more and more in this direction, and for sure some other innovations will be available. And next time I hope that I will be able to present them to them to you in presence and not just in Teams. So from my side, George, it's all.
So thank you very much. Thank you very much, Alessandro, for the really comprehensive presentation. Quite interesting, and always happy to see that everyone in the industry is moving towards a greener and more environmental friendly approach. It's something that is very much needed. And yes, so we currently have two questions in the chat. If anyone has any further questions, they can always drop a text in the chat or just raise their hands and they will be admitted. So let's start with the first one, without further ado, from Mr. Thomas Gramenos. And the question is, can you share with us the framework of norms and guidelines used to classify the conditioner's environmental impact levels as those presented?
I imagine about the soil conditioning we speak about?
Yes.
Okay, not so easy to reply to this because, as I said during the presentation, everywhere there is a different rule. The common rule that I think it's everywhere is to compare the natural soil with the soil with the conditioning and to check what there is inside. There is a list of things to be found, let's say, for example, hydrocarbons, heavy metals, organic content, and so on. Then there is a limit for each one substances that is accepted. So the first thing is that if all these things are okay, are below a limit, the waste, the muck is not a waste. Somewhere, for example, in UK or in Italy, they go much more in detail and there is a lot of investigation also about the ecotoxicity. In general, for example, in Italy, the approach is that the soil with the conditioning agent, so in general with the foam, must have the same ecotoxicity of the soil without any conditioning. Only in this case, the MAC can be considered like not like waste, so it can be reused for other applications.
Thank you. And the second one is from Ms. Marilia Balassi. Regarding soil conditioning, was there any case of tunneling very close to a large aquifer that is proven to provide drinking water, an example to a large city? Did you approach conditioning in a different or stricter even way?
Yeah, some case that I am aware at least about these. I remember a project in Copenhagen, so in Denmark, and also some of them in UK. So some of them have decided to excavate just with water in order to completely avoid this risk. In general, what we have provided in this case is to show that the addition of the foam has the lowest degree of impact against the water. So what I showed before, there is a possibility to certify these values. For example, with the laboratory that I showed before, we can have results of the biodegradability and in this case even more of the toxicity of the foam, because there is an attention to the water and to the organisms that live in water. So yeah, my experience in particular is this one.
Indeed. Thank you very much for that. Okay, we have no further questions, and personally, I would like to further comment on that, but let's keep that for the end of the webinar. We have the next session is planned for 6:30, and we have 5 minutes to have a short break and return to the second session. So thank you very much for your attendance, and please, a kind reminder to keep your microphones and cameras off during the presentation. Thank you.